Good morning.
Good morning.
For those of you who have looked ahead in the bulletin to see for the offertory song today, the song will be It Is Well With My Soul. For those of you who don't know who Horatio Spafford was, he was the man who wrote the song in the 19th century after a personal tragedy of unimaginable proportions. It's worth reading up about, really interesting thing. Before service this morning, the choir listened while you're in for a treat, because Lauren Corbin is going to sing that for you. I happen to be married to her, and I happen to know she sings it very well. But it was lovely, and she sang it in a very dignified way. But ironically, right as soon as she finished, one of our older choir members piped in, "It is well with my soul, but my knees sure do hurt." Would you join me in the call to worship? Turn the... Okay, does someone have the ability to turn the air off so that the people on the south side of the sanctuary are not too cold?
Tom. Mark.
Wonderful. Mark is going to take care of that for you. Call to worship. You are my God. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for to you I cry all day long. For you are great and do wondrous things. You alone are God.
Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart to revere your name.
Let us worship God. And now the prayer of praise and adoration. You incline your ear to hear us, O Lord, when we cry to you. You are a God of compassion who gently cares for our needs in times of distress. In Christ, you teach us your ways that we may walk in your truth. Your Spirit directs the way we shall go. As we discern your word, we hear how you are a God who can be trusted. Through the years, you have never forsaken those who called on your name. Hear us now as we offer our praise and thanksgiving. May they be worthy of your gracious care. And now I have a special request. We have a former choir member living out in the state of Washington. Her name is Marilyn Myers. I would like you to all turn and look up at Fred up there with his little camera and sing Happy Birthday to Marilyn Myers. Our prayer of confession.
Yes. We have to sing.
Oh, I apologize. I will sit down for a moment.
Mother, all
Now let us join together in the prayer of confession. Gracious God, in Christ Jesus, have mercy upon us. We are not quick to proclaim Christ as our Savior. We have our own desires that demand our devotion. Other people have power over us that we dare not deny. We sometimes confuse Christ's will with our own. At times it is awkward to confess Him as a new source of a life. With compassion He suffers, aware of our plight. O God, hear our confession, and through Christ keep us upright. Now we have an assurance of pardon. Paul reminds us how we must also consider ourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. For if we have been united with Him in a death like His, we will certainly be reunited with Him in a resurrection like His. In Christ we may live anew with the assurance of Jesus Christ that in Him we are forgiven. Would you sing Gloria Patri, number 812? Peace of God be with you. Greet one another in peace.
Thank you. morning, I'd like to invite the children to come forward. Good morning. Welcome. Oh, here comes some more. I thought I saw a few other little people around here. Hey, Sasha. Good morning, Natalie. Good morning. Glad you could be here with us today. Welcome to the church. How are you, Natalie? Oh, there she is. I gotta get one thing out of here. I'm trying to catch up with all the Sunday school kids this summer, and another one of our Sunday school youth was Kendall. And Kendall, this is to thank you for being a part of our Sunday school this year. All right, I think we've only got a couple more kids to catch up with. This is a really neat Sunday in that we're going to be talking about something that we face a lot, and that's being scared. Because that's just part of life, is sometimes things happen and we're scared or we feel alone. And in today's Bible study, we're going to be talking about two people, a woman named Hagar and a boy named Ishmael. And they found themselves alone. They were alone, and all they had was a little bit of water and a little bit of food. Well, one day that ran out, and they were out in the wilderness alone. And Ishmael crawled up under a bush and waited. And his mother sat across from him and cried. She cried to God, saying, "Please, don't let me watch my child die out here alone." And God heard their voices, and God said, "That will not happen. For I see you, and I know you're scared, and I know you feel alone, but I am always here." And he made water come from a rock, God did. And he said, "I will take care of you, and I will protect you." And that's something for us to think about, because maybe you're going to summer camp this year for the first time. Or maybe you're going to be starting at a new school this summer, this fall. Or maybe some of you are moving. I hope not, but maybe some of you are moving away. And you're going to be scared, and you're going to feel lonely, and you're going to feel like nobody cares. But I want you to know that no matter where you go and whatever you're doing, God sees you, and God cares. And God will provide what you need in your time. Let us pray. Lord, we are grateful that we have this example of Hagar and Ishmael, and we can look to them and know that no matter what circumstances we find ourselves in, Lord, you will provide. You will reach out, you will comfort, and you will guide. In your name we pray. Amen. And I've got a children's bulletin for you, something for you to do during the adult sermon. Yeah, you can color this. There's some bags in the back out in the hallway if you didn't grab one that have crayons, and some of them have pencils, I think, in them. There you go. Thank you. All right, we'll see you next week.
Before we begin, I'd like to just call your attention to our bulletin. And we've got the Halverson benediction at the end of the service. And we'll do that actually in the benediction section after the final hymn. So we will be doing that, and that will be our benediction. Our first scripture text today comes from Genesis chapter 21, starting at verse 8. The child grew and was weaned, and Abraham made a great feast on the day that Isaac was weaned. But Sarah saw the son of Hagar the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham, playing with her son Isaac. So she said to Abraham, "Cast out this slave woman with her son, for the son of this slave woman shall not inherit along with my son Isaac." The matter was very distressing to Abraham on account of his son. But God said to Abraham, Do not be distressed because of the boy and because of your slave woman. Whatever Sarah says to you, do as she tells you. For it is through Isaac that offspring shall be named for you. As for the son of the slave woman, I will make a nation of him, also because he is your offspring. So Abraham rose early in the morning and took bread and a skin of water and gave it to Hagar, putting it on her shoulder, along with the child, and sent her away. And she departed and wandered around in the wilderness of Beersheba. When the water in the skin was gone, she cast the child under one of the bushes. Then she went and cast down opposite him a good way off, about the distance of a bow shot, for she said, "Do not let me look at the death of the child." And as she sat opposite him, she lifted up her voice and wept. And God heard the voice of the boy, and the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What troubles you, Hagar? Do not be afraid, for God has heard the voice of the boy where he is. Come, lift up the boy and hold him fast with your hand, for I will make a great nation of him." Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. She went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink. God was with the boy, and he grew up. He lived in the wilderness and became an expert with the bow. He lived in the wilderness of Paran, and his mother got a wife from him from the land of Egypt. Our gospel text today comes from Romans chapter 6, starting at verse 1. What then should we say to this? Should we continue in sin in order that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who have died to sin go on living on it? Do you not know that all of us have been baptized into Christ Jesus? We're baptized into his death. Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we've been united with him in death like his, we will certainly be united with him in resurrection like his. We know that if our old self was crucified with him, so that the body of sin might be destroyed, and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you must also consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Our gospel text today comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 10, starting at verse 24. A disciple is not above the teacher, nor a slave above the master. It is enough for the disciple to be like the teacher and the slave like the master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not be made known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both body and soul in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Everyone there who acknowledges me before others, I will also acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I will also deny before my Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to bring peace on the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And one's foes will be the members of one's old household. Whoever loves father and mother more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. Lester was two grades ahead of me in school, and we had an aunt, my mom's youngest sibling, who was only 1 year older than my sister. Her name was Cynthia, and she came to visit us in Colorado, and she also brought her brother, who was 7 years older than her, the second youngest sibling of my mother. And I can't exactly remember where we had driven to, but we had driven someplace and we were driving home. And my Uncle David, he decided there was far too much noise in the back seat. And so he asked us to play a game to see how long we could keep silent. Well, my sister and my aunt, they tapped out pretty quick. They started giggling almost immediately. They had gotten to that giggle stage. And so my uncle didn't like that response, so he said, "I'll tell you what, if you keep quiet all the way home, when we get back to the house, I'll give you 50 cents. Again, my sister and aunt didn't last very long, but I was going to stay strong. I wanted that 50 cent. I knew I could stay quiet. And so I stayed quiet that whole ride home. And then we turned on the street where the house was. As we were driving down the street and getting very close to my house, my uncle turned to me and he said, "Mark, what are you going to do with that 50 cents? And I said, "Well, I thought," and he goes, "Ah, you're out." Some might consider that unfair. In fact, I felt a little sting of it at the moment, and I thought, well, that was pretty tricky. But I liked my Uncle David, and I realized that was probably a lesson there somewhere for me. Sometimes things are unfair, and we know that happens in life. Things are unfair. And in fact, in all of our scripture texts, we have nothing but unfairness as far as the eye can see. In our scripture text today from Genesis, we finally have the promise fulfilled to Sarah. She has a child. And after weaning him, he's probably about 2 years old when the celebration happens, they have a big celebration. And why not? Abraham is a very rich man by this point, and he wants to have a rich man celebration for his heir. And the reason they waited to have such a celebration till they were two is because infant mortality was quite high back then, and they knew if they could reach a child could reach the age of being weaned, that they had a much better chance of reaching adulthood. And so a huge party was thrown. Everybody's happy. Everybody's having fun until Sarah sees Ishmael playing with her son, Isaac. Now, Ishmael is about 13 years older than Isaac, so he's probably about 15 years old here. And when Sarah sees Ishmael and Isaac playing together, she gets very angry and upset. And she talks to Abraham and tells Abraham, "You have got to get rid of Hagar," who was the mother of Ishmael, "and Ishmael. You must cast them out, because it's through Isaac that your descendants will be numbered." Now, of course, this thing displeased Abraham greatly. He loved his son Ishmael. And of course, in his hopes and dreams, he always thought that Ishmael would be with him. And so he prays to God about this. And to his surprise, God tells him to listen to your wife, Sarah. Do as she has asked, because your descendants will be through Isaac. But I will make of Ishmael a great nation. And so he gets just the bare minimum provisions, and he gives them to Hagar and Ishmael, and he drives them out. Talk about being unfair. This breaks our notions of fairness in terms of inheritance, because Ishmael isn't going to get what we would consider even a penny of the inheritance from his father. His brother's going to get everything. That sounds a little unfair to us, at least as the notions we have today. The next thing, of course, that's unfair about it is this breaks the relationship between Ishmael and his father. Father, I'm sure he loved very deeply. There is a breaking of this relationship, and they will never again be together like they have been over all these years. That's pretty unfair to deny someone a relationship with their father. Not only that, but it's also very unfair to Hagar. Hagar would not be in this situation if it wasn't for Sarah, who decided to jumpstart the promises of God by taking advantage of a social custom of her day and having a child with her husband, with a slave girl that would be considered both Abraham and Sarah's child. Think of it as an ancient form of surrogacy. But after the child was born, Sarah started to hate Hagar, and so she didn't want her around. This is clearly unfair to Hagar to cast her out of the only group of social people that she has known. And then on top of that, there's a little matter that they're casting them out in a wilderness that is very difficult to survive in. They're going to die of thirst as that water quickly runs out. All of that sounds pretty unfair. Then we turn to our gospel lesson today. And what does Jesus tell his apostles? "If they have maligned me, they're going to malign you. If they have persecuted me, they are going to persecute you." Jesus is telling the apostles that they're going to suffer and their lives are going to be difficult. And then he tells them, "But take heart. Don't fear the one who can kill you. Fear the one who can kill you and then cast your soul into hell." None of that sounds very good, and it definitely sounds unfair. Why are the apostles' lives going to be so difficult? All they're trying to do is bring the good news of the gospel to the world. All they're trying to do is bring souls back to God through the grace of Jesus Christ. So why should they have to suffer so? And then Jesus goes on and tells them, I haven't come to bring peace, but a sword. When you go out in the world and you preach the good news, when you share the world the testimony about me, he says, it's not going to bring peace in society, but division. And he tells them, the very people that you preach the good news to, the very people who accept the good news, some of them, even their families are going to turn against them. Even their own families are going to turn them in so that they're put in prison or they're sold into slavery or all their things are confiscated, or indeed, some of them were killed, turned in by their own families. Jesus tells them, these people that are going to accept the testimony that you bring, they're going to suffer too. That doesn't sound fair. Why should they have to suffer? Why was there such persecution in the early Christian church? Why did they have to suffer so horribly just because they believed in Jesus Christ? None of that. None of that sounds very fair. And as we read through our scripture text today, we can ask a very important question, which is God unfair? And of course, this is a criticism that many outside the faith have, and it's called the problem of evil. If God is all-powerful, that is, can do everything, if God is good and loves us, then why is there so much injustice in the world? Why is there so much suffering? Why are so many things going wrong? If God is all-powerful and all-knowing, why doesn't God stop it? And then you can amend to that even so. If God is infinite, then why is anybody going hungry in our world today? Why is anybody thirsty? Why doesn't everybody have shelter? Why isn't everybody cared for in lavish comfort? It is called the problem of evil, and it is a very good question. If God can do all these things, and if God loves us, why do we see all the pain and the suffering in this world? And it is indeed, if all you look at is this world, if all you think about is what we can see and hear and taste and touch in this world, and all that science can bring to us, as great as that knowledge is, it does seem a little strange that a loving God, an all-powerful God, would allow all the suffering and pain in the world. Turning to our scripture text today from Romans, Paul tells us that we are going to be baptized into the death of Christ. In fact, he says, if you take Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you follow him, you are baptized into his death. Now, what is Paul talking about here? Well, Paul's not just talking about his death on the cross. He's not just talking about the death of one's own personality in the sense of self-sacrifice, but he's talking about being baptized into that entire way that Jesus lived his life. We are to seek as much as possible, as ever faltering as we are, as ever as incompletely as we do it, as many times as we mess up, we are to try to imitate Christ in this life. And Paul says, when we do that, sufferings are going to come. Trials are going to come. Temptations are going to come. Sometimes people aren't going to like us. Sometimes we're going to suffer simply for believing in Jesus Christ. Paul tells us that's what it means to be baptized into the death of Jesus. So clearly Paul is agreeing with all those who say God is unfair. Yes, yes, Paul does agree with everyone who claims that God is unfair. But that's not the whole story. Paul says if we are baptized into his death, if we accept the cross that we are asked to carry, which is some sort of self-sacrifice in life, if we are asked to suffer, if we were baptized into these things, Paul tells us, then we will also be baptized into Jesus' resurrection. We too will arise one day with a spiritual body, a body that does not grow old, a body that does not wear out, a body that is not subject to disease or illness. We too will one day receive a resurrection from the dead. Paul tells us if we have been baptized in the death of Jesus, then we will be baptized into his victory over death. Just as he won a victory over death once and for all, one day we will have a victory over death. Just as he rose from the dead, so shall we rise from the dead. Just as he sought to bring us back to God, so we will have a relationship through him where we will never again be separated from God. And not just God, but all of our fellow sons and daughters of God, we will never be separated from them ever again. Paul says if we were baptized into the death of Christ, into his pattern, into his self-sacrifice, taking our cross, all these things are going to be ours as well. And so Paul would say, yes, God is unfair, but not in the way that so many accuse God think. In fact, it's just the opposite. God is unfair on our behalf. Because there's not one of us, not a single one of us, that could merit a resurrection from the dead. There's not a single one of us who could merit or win a resurrected body. There's not a single one of us that could merit eternal and everlasting life. And yet God gives all these things to us by grace through Jesus Christ. Paul says, yes, life is going to be unfair. There are going to be times when we suffer and are persecuted. But he points to the graciousness of God and says in his own words, all these things are but light affliction compared to the glories that await us. Well, what did Paul know? Well, Paul received the 39 lashes that Jesus received before he was crucified 5 times. He received the Roman beating with rods, which was another horrific form of Roman punishment that was up there with the 39 lashes 3 times. He was taken outside a town, and the people stoned him to death until he breathed no more. And then God told him to get up, and he went to another town to preach the good news of the gospel. He spent years in prison that he didn't need to because he was guilty of no crimes. Paul knew all too well what it was to suffer in this world, to suffer unfairness. And yet he assures us that if we understand the good news of the gospel, if we understand the grace of God, the things that God is going to give us are so much more amazing, so much more incredible, that all those other things will one day pass away. Getting back to our scripture text today from Genesis, there are times when we look back on our life. Sometimes it's a year or two, sometimes it's even longer. There are some times when we can look back on our life and we can see that maybe something that was unfair that happened to us, maybe something we deserved but we didn't get, maybe something we wanted that we worked for that we didn't attain. Yet we can look back and we can see that by the grace of God, it's good that we didn't get that. It is a wonderful thing that we didn't attain what we wanted. It's a wonderful thing that we thought what we wanted at the time, but looking back on it, we know now, boy, I shouldn't have wanted that at all. Sometimes we can see that in our lives, and we can see that the graciousness of God is far greater than any unfairness we can point to in the world. We see that in our scripture text today from Genesis. After Hagar and Ishmael are cast out and just about the point of death, an angel of God is sent to them to protect them. And the angel tells Hagar what God is going to do for Ishmael. Because Abraham has been praying for Ishmael, not just before he cast him out, but at the entire time of his life, Abraham was constantly in prayer with God, praying for Ishmael. Because Abraham prayed for Ishmael, God told both Abraham and Hagar that God would protect Ishmael. He would multiply him, and he would make him the father of nations and peoples too. Now, what do we know about Ishmael? Well, the Bible tells us that he was a wild man, and that his hand was against every man, and every man's hand was against him. Now, what does that mean? Well, it means he wasn't a good man. And it means he wasn't a righteous man. And it means he wasn't the kind of individual who warned of the protection that God gave him, or the blessings that God gave him, or to multiply him like God gave to him. All that came to Ishmael through grace, simply because God was gracious to him because of the prayers of Abraham. Yes, in this world, we are going to suffer unfairness. Yes, we are going to at times suffer persecutions. Yes, at times, we are not going to have that peace we want, but division for when we stand up for what is right. Yes, these things are going to come, we're told. But we're told to not look to the unfairness of this world, but rather look to the unfairness of God, a God that is going to bless us in ways we cannot even imagine. And one day, the Apostle Paul tells us we will look back on all the unfairness, all the suffering, all the pain in the world, and it will simply melt away because of all the things God is going to give to us, simply because of the grace of Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for sending individuals before us to help us understand more about you. Pray all these things in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us say what we believe. Please repeat after me the affirmation of faith found in our bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Any announcements? Any prayer requests? Okay. Then let us gather together as God's people in prayer. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for the call that you have given us in Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord God, that you have called us to a ministry of compassion, a ministry where we reach out in ways that you have enabled us and blessed us to the world to let them know that you are a loving God and that you have wondrous plans for individuals who will put their hope and faith and trust in you, who grab hold of the good news in Jesus Christ, that you died for our sins. So much did you love us that you put our sins away once and for all through your Son's death on the cross. And that through his resurrection, through his ascension, through his sitting at the seat of power, You have promised to give us so many amazing and wondrous things, and indeed share in his reign someday. We thank you, Lord God, for this call that you've given us. We pray, Lord God, that your Spirit will bless us each day and help us to understand how precious this call is, to seek to grab hold of it, to seek to make it a part of our lives, to seek to make it a priority in our experience, and to remember that we are here a very brief time and that you have created us for an eternity with you. We'd also like to pray this day, Lord God, for those we know are going through difficulties and struggles and pains, both around the world and in our own little corner of the world. We pray for your Spirit and presence to be with them, to give them patience, to give them understanding, to give them healing, to give them hope. We pray, Lord God, that you'll bless all these individuals in this way. And now let us take a few moments to pray for those we're concerned about. God, we thank you for hearing our prayers for others. And now let us pray the prayer our Lord and Savior taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please join me in the prayer of dedication. O God, we have been led to acknowledge Christ as a source of new life. With Hagar, we have come to observe the wellsprings of your love. As you have called us to be your people, accept now the offering we bring. Use them to spread your message from east to west, from south to north, so that those who come after us may be led to proclaim God of their lives. Amen. Now let's sing. Yep. Before the Halverson benediction, we have one more announcement.
Yes.
And that is we have another birthday that we want to recognize, and that would be Kay. So we're going to sing happy birthday to her.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Kay. Happy birthday to you.
And we have a celebration downstairs, so please come down and celebrate with us. And now the Halverson benediction. You go nowhere by accident. Wherever you go, God is sending you. Wherever you are, God has put you there. He has a purpose in your being there. Christ, who indwells you, has something he wants to do through you where you are. Believe this and go in his grace and love and power. Amen.